Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. Why is that so dark? That's weird. Well, if you're watching the replay, thanks so much for joining me here. I am so excited that you have decided to jump in. Hey, Aisha, girl, you are always like the first one in the camp. It's like you sitting up waiting. But you know what? That's good. I like that. That's good. That's good. It's bright. Is it bright? John, is my screen bright? Does it look weird? It's okay for you on your end, is what you're saying? It just looks dark on my end. Maybe. Oh, well, I'm not going to worry about it. Okay. Hi, good morning, Pastor Chris. How are you, sir? Not too bright. Okay, great. Great, great, great. Awesome. 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 Good morning. Good morning. So glad to see you all coming in on the scope this morning. Not the scope, but the live broadcast. Hope you all had a fantastic week. Let's see. We've been doing this now. I think this is the fourth. Is this the fourth week? The fourth one that we've done where we've met? Y'all remind me. Is this the fourth one? I'm excited because God is just building and encouraging me along the way and teaching me some things and telling me some things. So I'm really excited about what he's building towards. It's funny, I was thinking today, you know, I've had WLA since 2004, and it has just gone from one dimension to another dimension to another. And just to think about where we were when we first started. Good morning from Virginia. So glad to see you this morning. I just started with an idea of just, you know, bringing worship leaders together. Good morning, Stephanie. That they would be able to find people that are doing what they do, you know, and have some relationship, you know, with people who do what we do. That's really what it was founded upon, to create and foster relationships among people who do what we do. You know, and I just had a couple of worship leaders that we would get together once every 3 months over lunch. And then we had a strategic withdrawal where we went to, I think it was Destin Beach, with our spouses, and just had a time. First we got together, we had an evening of worship and just, you know, a time of prayer and seeking God. Good morning. And, lunch. You like the idea of lunch. but then we had, and then the next morning we had just a time of just chilling out and catching up and fellowshipping with one another. And so, you know, I'm looking forward to doing something like that again. From time to time here in Orlando, we'll get together and we'll have a worship leaders fellowship. I haven't done one, gosh, in a few months now. So, we may need to do that here in Orlando, and maybe, you know, in Georgia, Pastor Chris Daigle, where you are, and the sister that was in Virginia, you know, you do some a worship leaders fellowship, and you know, under with WLA, I'd love to help you get that situated and start fellowshipping with some worship leaders in your area. You know, we're building community, and not just community, you know, online, but community in your community, you know. So let's, you know, if those of you that are interested in doing that, you know, let's chat, inbox me, and yeah, you do that in Durham, North Carolina. I think that's awesome, because, you know, sometimes worship leading can be a lonely position, you know, and so it's just great to have people that understand where you are, that you can just break bread with and communicate with and share ideas. So anyway, let me get keep moving here. The last 2 weeks I was talking about building a team of leadership within your team, and just the excellence and the order and the structure that builds and that creates and it promotes for your team. So I kind of want to continue in that same vein and talk about expectations and guidelines for your team. So those of you that are here right now, you may already have something like this in place, but maybe there may be someone who doesn't have that in place and they're wondering, how can I get my team you know, to do what, to do some of the things that I'm needing them to do. Well, I think when you have, when you put everything out front in the very beginning, and I say the very beginning, some of you may have already been serving for a time, but you know, it's no better time than right now than to start something new. So if you have a time where you just sit and say, hey, okay, this is what we're doing. We're starting something new. We're establishing some guidelines and some expectations that we're going to set in place. So the benefits of having guidelines and structure, or guidelines and expectations, number one, the first benefit is that it brings order. It brings structure to your team. You know, God is a God of order. He is not the author of chaos. He is the God of order. And, you know, even when in Exodus chapter 26, on when Moses was, when he was taking the children of Israel and they were building the and establishing the tabernacle, God was very specific with what he wanted to go where. You know, and I was kind of reading through some of the instructions of it. And it was like, oh my gosh, it was like every little detail down to the type of ring that was holding the curtains. And even beyond that, he was so specific as to say who could carry what specific item that was going into the tabernacle. So God was is a God of order. And, you know, we talked a couple of weeks ago that when you have order and when you have structure, that also promotes growth. So, you know, so the first benefit of having expectations and guidelines in place for your team is that it brings order and structure. Okay. The second benefit of having expectations and guidelines in place, and this is not just for your choir, but this is for your musicians. This is for your praise team. This is for your sound team. This is for your dance team, your sign language, your deaf ministry, even for the ushers and the greeters. Every area of ministry should have guidelines and expectations in place to bring order and to bring structure. The other benefit is that it brings commitment. It brings commitment. The reason why it brings commitment is because people will know what to expect, and they will also know what is expected of them. And right off the bat, if you have people who are coming to serve in your area of ministry, they'll know what's expected, and then they'll say, okay, then that'll give them the opportunity to freely commit and say, oh, okay, well, I can do that. Yeah, I can do that. Or, you know, I've even had people to say, well, I really want to be a part, but I work on this such and such a day, so I won't necessarily be able to come to all of the rehearsals, but if my guidelines say you have to attend all of the rehearsals, then they know, you know, there's no gray area about it. Either you can attend all of the rehearsals or you can't commit to this area of ministry. So it gives people the opportunity to freely commit because they know what is expected of them. And the other thing is that it sets standards. It shows people that, hey, if you want to come and serve in this area of ministry, these are the guidelines and these are the standards that we have in place. People want to be a part of something that's excellent. They want to be a part of something that they know is not, and I talked about this before, that's not crazy and unorganized. People want to be a part of things that are in order, right? So it sets standards for those that are serving. It leaves few opportunities for people to just kind of do whatever they want to do, right? So it sets standards when you have expectations and guidelines for your team. The other thing is that it creates and it promotes excellence. And I've said that word a couple of times already. It promotes excellence. Our pastor did a leadership workshop for those that are serving. Those are volunteering for the church. And he addressed excellence, and he said that excellence it promotes, or it is intentional attention to details, right? And so when you give attention to details, it promotes it gives you the opportunity to be promoted. It gives you the opportunity to have praise from God. God excels. He promotes you when you are giving attention to details. So when we have when we have expectations and guidelines, it allows you to give attention to details. And when I say attention to details, that allows you to address. Good morning, Michael. That allows you to address whatever that you think would be a concern for you or for your team. So you can address attendance. You can address attire. You can address the days of serving, the days that you're expecting them to serve. So, for example, with attendance, and this has saved me so much, I have a guideline in place that if you miss two or more unexcused absences, then you'll be placed on a leave of absence. So what does that mean? That means if you don't show up, whether it's to rehearsal or to service, twice without saying anything to anyone, then we're going to contact you. You know, of course we want to know, we're going to find out what's going on, if everything is okay. But upon that, if we don't hear from you, you'll be placed on a leave of absence. If you have four rehearsals that you can't attend, say you're taking a class or you're working somewhere and your schedule will not allow you to attend a month of services or a month of rehearsals, then we're going to go ahead and put you on a leave of absence, of excused absences. So if you have four excused absences, then we're going to just go ahead and consider you on a leave of absence. And that just, you know, that frees me up, that frees you up. You don't feel like, oh, I got to let them know that I'm not going to be here for the month, or I'm not looking and wondering, well, I wonder if they're coming today. The leave of absence, you can determine that as the team leader. You know, you tell me, how long will you need to be? Will you need to take 6 weeks of leave of absence? Okay, great. You know, and when they come back, depending on how long they've been gone, you know, you can just determine what the protocol is for when they return. If someone has been, you know, like some people are taking classes, and so, you know, that's going to be about 3 months where they're out of service, right? Out of serving on your team. So in 3 months, you could have learned six new songs. I'm just throwing that number out there. So, you know, and then if they've not been attending the rehearsals during those 3 months, but you've seen them in service, then you know they're kind of familiar with the song. So you can kind of, you can determine, you know, what your protocol is for them to return. Sometimes I'll say, well, just attend two rehearsals before you're serving again, you know. And when you do that, it just reinforces the idea that this is a standard and this is a privilege to be able to serve in this area of ministry. The other benefit that I'm going to go to and end with is that it creates accountability for one another. To whom much is given, much is required. And so when you set these standards, you know, you're saying, listen, I'm not going to allow you to just kind of come and go whenever you want, or we're not going to just allow you to just kind of do whatever you want to do when you are and serving in this ministry. We have the standard set, and so we're going to hold you to this standard, and we're not going to, you know, this is what, we're not going to just allow you to just kind of do whatever. Again, to whom much is given, much is required. So the team knows that this is not just, you know, just some willy-nilly little area that you, oh, you sing great, come on and sing. No, this is a standard. These are expectations and these are guidelines and things that we expect from you. Okay. So, I just think it's really important that if you have expectation, you set them in place so that way when people are coming to be a part of your team, they know right off the bat, this is a privilege that I get to be a part of this community of worshipers. I get to be a part of a people who count it as an honor to be able to serve this ministry or serve our church with leading worship. I'm not just looking for a bunch of good singers who sing everywhere all around town. I'm looking for people who have a heart to serve God and a heart to offer their life as a living sacrifice. And so, you know, I tell my team often, I say, you know, serving in this area of ministry does, it leaves you with fewer options than just the regular lay person. You're in leadership here. And though you might not be standing holding a mic, or you may not be leading a song, you are in leadership. And so you don't get to just go and just live and do whatever, or come and go as you please. You're in leadership. And so there's a higher standard and a higher call that I'm expecting from you. So, okay. But that's all I wanted to share with you all this morning about having guidelines and expectations in place. All right. So if you need any help, or if you have any questions about that, feel free to jot them down in the chat. This video will be up for the rest of until it'll be up there. But if you have any questions, or you are working on revamping policies and procedures handbook, which is what we call it here at the River, and you need some extra input, just shoot me an email and I'd love to help you out. Okay. All right. Listen, I am in the process of developing a summit group. So we're going to have a summit group. Now, what does that mean? That means that for those of you that have been watching this live video, you've been enjoying this information that I've been giving, the summit group you'll have an opportunity to be a part of, and you'll be able to get some more in-depth teaching and in-depth training for your team and for your assignment that you have as a worship leader. So if that is something that you're interested in, just keep looking for it. I'll be sending you information about the summit group really, really, really soon. All right. Elder Calloway, please inbox me. Send me an inbox and let's chat. I'd love to help you out however I can. Okay. All right, you guys. Have a fantastic Tuesday. Jesus loves you so, so much. And I do too. Have a great day. Thanks for watching. Bye-bye.